Listening Library presents The Rose Society by Marie Lu. Read for you by Carla Corvo and Lannon Killea. Adelina Amouteru. When I was a little girl, my mother would spend long afternoons telling me old folk tales. I remember one story particularly well. Once upon a time, a greedy prince fell in love with a wicked girl. The prince had far more than he needed, but it was never enough. When he grew ill, he visited the kingdom of the great ocean, where the underworld meets the living world, to bargain with Merroutas, the goddess of death, for more life. When she refused, he stole her immortal gold and fled to the surface. In revenge, Merroutas sent her daughter, Caldora, the Angel of Fury, to retrieve him. Caldora materialized out of the sea foam on a warm, stormy night, clad in nothing but silver silk, an achingly beautiful phantom in the mist. The prince ran to the shore to greet her. She smiled at him and touched his cheek. "What will you give me in return for my affection?" she asked. "Are you willing to part with your kingdom, your army, and your jewels?" The prince, blinded by her beauty and eager to boast, nodded. "Anything you want," he replied. "I am the greatest man in the world. Even the gods are no match for me." So he gave her his kingdom, his army, and his jewels. She accepted his offerings with a smile, only to reveal her true angel form, skeletal, finned, monstrous. Then she burned his kingdom to the ground and pulled him below the sea into the underworld, where her mother, Merroutas, was patiently waiting. The prince tried once again to bargain with the goddess, but it was too late. In exchange for the gold he'd stolen, Merroutas devoured his soul. I think of this story now as I stand with my sister on the deck of a trading ship, looking toward the shore where the city-state of Merroutas rises out of the morning mist. Someday, when I am nothing but dust and wind, what tale will they tell about me? Once upon a time, a girl had a father, a prince, a society of friends. Then they betrayed her, and she destroyed them all. City-state of Merroutas, the Sealands. They were the flash of light in a stormy sky, the fleeting darkness before dawn. Never have they existed before, nor shall they ever exist again. Unknown source on the young elites. Adelina Amouteru. I think he might be here. I'm startled from my thoughts by my sister Violetta's voice. "Hmm?" I murmur, looping my arm through hers as we wind our way through a crowded street. Violetta purses her lips in a familiar expression of concern. She can tell I'm distracted, but I'm grateful she decides to let it go. I said I think he might be here in the main square. It is early evening on the longest day of the year. We are lost in the thick of a celebration in the city-state of Merroutas, the wealthy, bustling crossroads between Kenettra and the Temoran Empire. The sun has nearly dipped below the horizon, and the three moons hang low and plump, ripe golden orbs suspended over the water. Merroutas is alight with festivities for the midsummer feast of creation, the start of a month of fasting. Violetta and I wander through the throngs of revelers, lost amid the celebration's rainbow of colors. Both of us are dressed in Temoran silks tonight, our hair wrapped up and our fingers adorned with bronze rings. People draped in jasmine garlands are everywhere, packed into the narrow alleys and spilling out into the squares, dancing in long lines around domed palaces and bathing temples. We walk past waterways swollen with cargo-laden boats and buildings carved in gold and silver with thousands of repeating circles and squares. Ornate tapestries hang from balconies in the smoky air. Soldiers pass us by in small clusters, wearing billowing silks instead of heavy armor, a moon and crown emblem stitched onto their sleeves. They're not the Inquisition Axis, but no doubt they've heard news of Terran's orders from across the sea to find us. We steer clear of the soldiers. I feel as if I were in a haze, the celebrations floating around me. It's strange, really, to look out at all of this joy. What do I do with it? It doesn't feed my energy. Instead, I stay silent, letting Violeta guide us through the busy streets as I return to my dark thoughts. Since leaving Kenettra 3 weeks ago, I have woken to whispers at my bedside that fade away seconds later. Other times, the hushed voices talk to me when no one else is around. They are not always there, and I cannot always understand them even when they are speaking to me. But I can always feel their presence lingering in the corners of my mind. There is a blade there, a rotation of sound and silence, a lamp that burns black, a grim, growing fire. This is what they say. Adelina, why do you blame yourself for Enzo's death? I should have had better control over my illusions. I respond quietly to the whispers. I could have saved Enzo's life. I should have trusted the dagger sooner. None of it was your fault, the whispers in my head argue. You didn't kill him after all. It was not your weapon that ended his life. So why are you the one cast out? You didn't have to return to the daggers. You didn't need to help them rescue Raffaele. And still they turned on you. Why does everyone forget your good intentions, Adelina? Why feel guilty for something that isn't your fault? Because I loved him, and now he is gone. It's better this way, the whispers say. Haven't you always waited at the top of the stairs imagining yourself a queen? Adelina, Violeta says. She tugs on my arm and the whispers scatter. I shake my head and force myself to concentrate. Are you sure he's here? I ask. If not him, then another elite. We've come to Merroutas to flee the Inquisition's prying eyes in Kenettra. It is the nearest place outside of Kenetran control, but eventually we'll make our way south to the Sunlands, far from their reach. But we also came here for another reason. If you had heard stories about only one young elite, they would have been about a boy named Maggiano. Raffaele, the beautiful young consort who was once my friend, mentioned Maggiano during my afternoon training sessions with him. Since then, I've heard his name on the lips of countless travelers. Some say he was raised by wolves in the dense forests of the Ember Isles, a tiny chain of islands far east of Kenettra. Others say he was born in the hot sunland deserts of Domaka, a bastard brought up by wandering nomads. He's rumored to be a wild boy, almost feral, dressed from head to toe in leaves, with a mind and hands as quicksilver as a midnight fox. He appeared quite suddenly several years ago and has since avoided arrest by the Inquisition Axis dozens of times for everything from illegal gambling to stealing the Kenetran Queen's crown jewels. As the stories go, he can lure you straight off a cliff and into the sea with music from his lute. And when he smiles, his teeth shine wickedly bright. Though we know he is a young elite, no one can say for certain what his power is. We can only be sure that he was recently seen here in Merroutas. If I were still the same girl from a year ago, before I knew I had powers, I'm not sure I would have the courage to search for such a notorious elite. But then I killed my father. I joined the Dagger Society. I betrayed them and they betrayed me. Or perhaps it was the other way around, I can never be sure. What I do know is that the daggers are my enemies now. When you're all alone in a world that hates and fears you, you want to find others like yourself. New friends. Elite friends. Friends who can help you build your own society. Friends like Maggiano. Salam, lovely Tamoran girls. We enter another large square near the bay. All along the sides are food stalls with steaming pots and street operators in long-nosed masks performing table tricks. One of the food vendors smiles when we look at him. His hair is hidden behind a Tamoran wrap, and his beard is dark and well-trimmed. He bows to us. I touch my own head instinctively. My silver hair is still short and scraggly from my attempt to cut it off, and it stays hidden tonight behind two long strips of gold silk adorned with a headdress of gold tassels dangling above my brows. I have woven an illusion over the scarred side of my face. To this man, My pale lashes are black and my eyes are flawless. I glance at what he's selling, steaming pans of stuffed grape leaves, lamb skewers, and warm flatbread. My mouth waters. "Pretty girls from the homeland," he coos at us. I don't understand the rest of what he says other than, "Please come and break your—"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.